Hello and welcome to our channel. This time we will be presenting Seven Wonders Duel, a game from the Seven Wonders family that has been perfectly adapted to two-player games. Players will have to gather resources in order to build the best buildings and wonders throughout three different ages. This game is suitable for people over 10 and lasts approximately 30 minutes. Let's see what Seven Wonders Duel is about! Before analyzing the components, we would like to tell you that there are expansions for Seven Wonders Duel which offer new game modes. To know more about them, click on the link to watch our videos. In addition to the rulebook, a scorepad and a help sheet, we also find one game board, one conflict pawn, 4 military tokens, 7 guild cards, 10 progress tokens, 12 wonder cards, 23 H1 cards, 23 H2 cards, 28 H3 cards and 31 coins of different value. H and guild cards represent buildings. All of them have a name, a construction cost and effect once they have been built in your city. There are 7 different types of buildings, easily identifiable by their color. Brown cards produce the following raw materials. Gray cards produce manufactured goods. Blue cards represent civilian buildings and they are worth victory points. Green cards represent scientific buildings and they grant a scientific symbol and sometimes victory points.
Yellow cards depict commercial buildings. They are worth coins, produce resources, change the trading rules and are sometimes worth victory points.
Red cards represent military buildings. They increase your military power. Finally, purple cards are guilds. They allow you to score points based on a specific criteria. The H3 deck doesn't contain raw materials or manufactured goods. However, we must include 3 guild cards. Each large card represents a wonder from the Age of Antiquity. They also consist of a name, a construction cost, and an effect. We must first place the board between the two players on one side of the play area. Then, we must put the conflict pawn in the middle of the board, as well as the 4 military tokens faced up on their spaces. Next, randomly choose 5 progress tokens and place them face up on the board. Return the rest to the box. Each player takes 7 coins from the bank. Now, we should choose the wonders. First, we will have to choose a starting player. Then, we must shuffle the 12 wonder cards. Randomly choose 4 of them and place them face up between both players. The starting player will choose a wonder, the other player will choose 2, and the remaining one will be for the starting player. Then, the process will be repeated again. But this time the second player will be the first one to choose. After doing it, each player will have 4 wonders for the game, which must be placed in a column to the left of their play area. Now, we will see what to do with the cards of the different ages. The game will be divided into 3 different ages and for each of them there is a different deck of cards. First, we will have to return 3 cards from each age deck without looking at them. Then, we will have to randomly draw 3 guild cards, and without looking at them, we will have to add them to the H3 deck. Return the remaining guilds to the box. At the beginning of each age, shuffle the corresponding deck, and then display the 20 cards according to the structure of the current age. In the first age, we will have the following structure. Take into account that some of the cards are displayed face up, while others should be face down, so be careful when placing them. Once the card structure for the first age is placed, we will be ready to start playing. We will play in turns. On your turn, you must choose a card from the structure that is not partially covered by another card. With this first structure, we see that we could take any of the cards from the row below, but not from the other rows because they are covered by other cards. Once you have drawn your card, you can perform several actions. At the end of your turn, reveal any cards which are now accessible in the structure. One of the possible actions could be to add the card to your city. As the game progresses, you will have more cards in your city, but in order to do it, you will have to pay the cost specified on them. Some cards have no cost, and therefore, they can be put into play for free. Others will have a resource cost. Resources will be produced as you get brown or grey cards. Some yellow cards and some wonders will also give you resources. If you lack any resources to buy a card, you can always get them from the bank. The cost of each missing resource varies over the course of the game. It will be 2 coins plus the number of symbols of the same resource that your opponent has in their city. For instance, if we needed clay, we should pay 2 coins to the bank, But since our opponent has a clay symbol in their city, we should pay an additional coin. Some cards require a cost in coins. From H2 on, apart from coins, they may also ask for resources. Other cards will have a white symbol at the top that will link them to cards from ages 2 and 3. If you decide to draw a card that contains one of those symbols in its cost area, you can get it for free if you already have a card with that symbol in your city. Otherwise, you will have to pay its regular cost in order to buy it. This way, we will get cards that will offer us different resources and benefits to be used throughout the game. Sort them by color to make your city easier to be read. Another action that we could do on our turn is to obtain coins. We must discard the card that we have taken from the structure by placing it face down next to the board. The cards that are discarded can be consulted by both players at any point. By discarding the card, we get 2 coins from the bank, plus an additional coin for each yellow card that we have in our city. Therefore, in this case, we get 4 coins from the bank. We could also build a wonder. To do it, players must pay the cost the wonder requires. In this case, 1 papyrus, 2 pieces of glass, and 2 bricks of clay. Be careful, don't pay the cost of the edge card you have just drawn. You will have to place this card face down so that it is partially covered by the wonder you have just built. It has no effect, it simply indicates that you have built a wonder. Only 7 wonders may be built over the course of the game. As soon as either player constructs the game's 7th wonder, the last wonder, which has not been built yet, is immediately returned to the box. Let's see how the military cards work. Each time we draw a red card, we will move the conflict pawn on the board towards our opponent's capital as many spaces as shields on the card. If we draw a card with 2 shields, we will move the pawn 2 spaces. When the conflict pawn enters a zone defined by dotted lines, the attacking player applies the effect of the corresponding token and then returns the token to the box. In this example, the opponent loses 2 coins that are returned to the bank. Green cards will give us scientific symbols. There are 7 different symbols. Each time you gather a pair of identical symbols, you may immediately choose one of the progress tokens on the game board. That token will remain in your city until the end of the game. Each progress token has different benefits or rewards. In this case, any future blue card will cost 2 resources less. You are free to choose the resources you don't want to pay. An age ends when all 20 cards from the structure have been played. Then, prepare the next stage's structure. The player with the weakest military chooses which player begins the next stage. A player has a weaker military if the conflict pawn is on their side of the board. In a situation where the pawn is in the middle of the board, the player who begins the next stage is whoever played the last card in the previous age. We will continue playing until one of the following things happens. If during the game the conflict pawn reaches your opponent's capital square, you will automatically win the game. This is called military supremacy. If any of the players manages to collect 6 different scientific symbols, they will also automatically win the game. This is called scientific supremacy. However, if no player has won through any of these 2 supremacies before the end of H3, the player who has the most victory points wins the game. We will start by adding up the victory points from the cards. Each player should add up the points from the cards they have in their city. First, we will check the victory points from the blue cards. We see that player 1 scores 26 points, while player 2, 20 points. Then, we will add the points of the green cards. We see that player 1 scored 7 points and player 2, 1 point. We will continue with the yellow cards. In this case, player 1 scores 6 points and player 2, 9. Next, we will check the guild cards. They all have special scoring conditions. In this case, player 1 has 3 cards. The first one is worth 1 victory point for each blue card in the city which has the most blue cards. The second one is worth 1 victory point for each green card in the city which has the most green cards. And the last guild card is worth 1 victory point for each brown and grey card in the city which has the most brown and grey cards. Therefore, in this case, player 1 gets 17 points for their guild cards, while player 2 doesn't score anything since there aren't any purple cards in their city. So far, player 1 has 56 points and player 2, 30. Once the victory points from the cards are added, the military points will be scored. We will have to check the board to see which player gets them. One of the players could score 2, 5 or 10 points depending on where the conflict pawn is at the end of the game. In this case, player 2 scores 5 victory points. Next, we will have to add up the victory points from the wonders that each player has managed to wield. In this example, player 1 will score 6 victory points, while player 2, 9. We also have to check the progress tokens that each player has obtained to see if they offer victory points. In this case, player 1 has obtained a progress token, but it isn't worth victory points. Player 2 doesn't have any progress tokens, therefore, none of them will score victory points for progress tokens. Finally, the coins that players have at the end of the game are also worth some victory points. Each set of 3 coins will be worth 1 point. In this case, player 1 has 24 coins, scoring 8 points, and player 2 has 29 coins, which are 9 victory points. Adding up all the victory points, we see that player 1 has 70 points and player 2 53. Therefore, player 1 becomes the winner. In the event of a tie, the player with the most victory points for their blue cards wins the game. If still tied, then both players will share the victory. In short, Seven Wonders Duel is a great game for two players that with very simple mechanics results in intense and entertaining games. The different ways in which you can achieve victory during the game makes it even more exciting, as you must be aware of your opponent's actions while you focus on your own goals. Nonetheless, sometimes chance may jeopardize your strategy, and if you don't obtain enough resources at the beginning of the game, you may be in trouble during the last stage. Therefore, sometimes games can be a little bit unbalanced. The cards are too small and thin, so we recommend sleeving them to protect them. If you like competitive games in which you can follow a strategy that favors you, but also allows you to annoy your opponent, you will certainly enjoy Seven Wonders Duel. What do you think about this game? We hope to read your comments, and remember, if you have enjoyed watching this video, don't forget to like it. To be up to date with our latest videos, subscribe to the channel and click the bell. We will continue playing in our next video.